Welcome to the lecture on variables and data types. In this lecture, we are going to look at how to name variables, some of the common rules and conventions in naming a variable. We are also going to look at some of the basic data types that we are going to use throughout this course and in Python. As a part of this task, we are going to look at how to identify a data type of an object, how to verify if an object is of a certain data type, and how to coerce objects to a new data type. So, let us begin with naming variables. So, values are assigned to variables using the assignment operator equal to. So, the variable names should be short and descriptive, and that is because there is an intent for creating the variable and it is supposed to convey an information. Hence, it is better that it is short and descriptive. So, avoid using variable names that clash with inbuilt functions. Like I earlier said, the variable names are designed to indicate the intent and purpose of its use to the end user. So, hence it is better to avoid one character variable names. So, one character variable names are usually used in iterations and functions and looping constructs. So, variables can be named alphanumerically. So, if I have a variable called age whose value is 55, then I can either have the entire age in lowercase or I can also begin with an uppercase. You can also add a number to it. So, let us say if I am creating another variable called h2, then I can add the number after the alphabets. So, one thing that you would have noticed here is that the first letter should always begin with an alphabet, but however, if you were to begin with the number, the compiler throws an error saying invalid syntax. So, the only other special character that is allowed while naming a variable is underscore. Now, let us say if I want to create a variable that conveys the employee ID, then I can separate the employee and ID with an underscore. Now, underscore is the only other special character that is allowed. Now, if you use any of the other special characters, you will get an error that says can't assign to the operator. So, though underscore is allowed, it is better to not begin or end with an underscore, and that is a common unaccepted naming convention, though it is accepted by the compiler. So, if you begin or end with an underscore, you are not likely to get an error. So, it is usually not a practice that is followed. So, there are a few case types that is commonly accepted while naming variables. The first is the camel case. It can be lower or upper. First example that you have here where age of the employee is given with E in capital. Now, this is a lower camel case. So, the example on the right is an example for the upper camel case. Now, in this example, the letter A in age of the employee begins with a capital letter. So, the next case type is the snake case where I am separating age and M by an underscore. So, an underscore can be used between two set of letters or between two letters, and that is a snake case. The letter after the underscore should always be in lowercase, but the first letter of the variable name can be in lower or uppercase. The next case type is Pascal. So, where I am again going to take age M. Now, here the first letter of age is in uppercase and the first letter of M is also in uppercase. Now, these are the commonly used case types in Python. Now, the compiler is not going to throw an error if you name the variables wrongly, but these are conventions that are in books and are accepted. However, there are other case types which use hyphen, but those case types will not be allowed in Python. So, if you want to assign multiple values to a variable, you can create all the variable at once and sequentially assign the value. Now, if you run this command, you will see that the values of the variables chemistry, mathematics and physics have been assigned accordingly. So, now let us look at the commonly used data types in Python. So, the basic data types are Boolean, which represents two values of logic and are associated with a conditional statement. So, the output values that you would get when you use a Boolean data type is true or false, and it is represented as bool. The next data type is integer. It consists of set of all integers which are positive or negative whole numbers. It is represented by the letters int. The next data type is complex, which contains real and imaginary part. So, any expression of the form a plus ib is of a complex data type. It consists of all complex numbers and it is represented by complex. Now, float data type consists of all real numbers which are of floating point numbers. it is represented by float. String data type consists of all strings and characters. So, anything that is enclosed between single or double quotes is treated as a string data type. The value that is enclosed between the quotes can be a number, a special character, alphabets, anything. So, anything that is contained within quotes is treated as a string data type. It is represented by the letters str. Now, before we go ahead with data type operations, it is important to know the difference between a statistically and a dynamically typed language. So, a statistically typed language is the one where the type of the variable is known at the compile time, and you also have to declare the data type of the variables upfront. So, examples of such programming languages are C, C++ and Java. So, contrary to this, a dynamically typed language is the one where the data type need not be declared upfront. The type of the variable is known only at the runtime. So, whenever you declare a variable and you assign a value of it, the moment you run that specific line, the data type of the variable is known. Examples of such languages are Python, PHP. So, Python that we are using here is a dynamically typed language. So, let us go further and see how to identify the data type of an object. Now, to find the data type of an object, you will be using the function type and give the object as an input. Now, an object can be a variable, can be any of the data structures, it can be arrays or anything. In this case, in particular, we are just going to look at how to find the data type of variables. Now, let us take a small example here. I have three variables here. The first is employee underscore name, which is the name of the employee, and the value is Ram enclosed between double quotes. Next is age of the employee, represented by the variable name age, the value for which is 55. The third variable is height, which is the height of the employee, whose value is 150.6. Now, if you want to check the data type, you can give type of employee name. Now, employee name is a string because it is enclosed between double quotes. If you give type of age, age is an integer and hence the output is int. And if you give type of height, which is a floating point number, the data type is float. So, now let us see how to verify the data type of an object. Now, if you want to verify if an object belongs to a certain data type, then you basically give type of the object, in this case it is the variable name, followed by the keyword is and the data type name. So, this data type will basically be the representation of the data type. Int is for integer, str is for string, so on and so forth. Now, I am going to use the same example that I have used earlier. Now, here I would like to verify if height is of integer data type. So, I am giving type of height followed by is and the keyword int, which is the abbreviation for integer data type. So, one important thing to keep in mind while verifying the data type is that in this case the output is just going to be Boolean. So, the output is going to be true or false. We are actually checking, given a variable, does it belong to a desired data type or not. We are not trying to assign it or change it, but what we are just trying to do is just cross verification. So, hence the output for this is either going to be true or false. So, I want to know if age belongs to a float data type, which is false because age is actually an integer. Now, in this case, I want to check if employee name is a string. Yes, the output is true because it is a string. So, till now we have seen how to find the data type of an object. We have also seen how to verify if an object has a desired data type. Now, we are going to look at how to coerce object to newer data types. Now, if I want to convert the data type of an object to another, I will be using the data type. You need to replace data type with the abbreviation used for each of the data types, and you give the object as the input here. Now, all the changes that have been made to the variables can be stored in the same variable or a different variable. Now, in this case, height is of a float data type. Let us say I want to convert it to an integer data type. So, I say int of height, which converts it to an integer data type. But if I want these changes to be reflected in my environment, I have to store it onto a variable. Now, the variable can have the same name or a different name. So, in this case, I am converting height to an integer data type and I am storing it onto a new variable called ht. Now, if I get the type of ht, the output is int, which means height has been converted to an integer data type. Now, if I want to reflect the changes on the same variable name, I will just say height equal to int of height. So, earlier height was float. Now, once the operation is done, if you check the type of height again, the output that you will be getting is int. So, this is how you would coerce existing objects to newer data types. So, one important point here is that only few types of coercions are accepted. Now, let us say I have a variable called salary tier, which is a string data type. Now, salary tier contains an integer which is enclosed between single quotes. So, in this case, the salary tier is basically a number which is 1, but that is enclosed within single quotes. So, it is still treated as a string data type. Now, if I want to change it to an integer, I will just say salary tier is equal to int of salary tier. Now, this will convert the data type for salary tier. So, now the data type is converted from string to an integer. However, not all types of coercion is possible. For instance, if I would like to convert the employee name Ram to an integer or a float, I will be getting an error. So, the value which is enclosed between quotes, if it is a float or an integer type, then such types of coercion will be possible. However, if it is a string or a set of characters, then those types of coercion would not be possible. So, to summarize, in this lecture, we looked at some of the common naming conventions to name a variable in Python. We saw some of the basic data type related operations. One of that was to get the data type of a variable, then verify if a variable is of a certain data type, and how to coerce the data type of an existing variable to a newer one. Thank you.